thank you for the blessed privilege of being washed in the precious blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. You give me reason to worship this morning. You're an awesome God. You're a great God. We can depend upon you each and every day. You never let us down. You're always there. You're running after us each and every day. Father, I thank you so much for being so committed to us. And I pray that, Father, as we worship you, we think about that commitment that we have to you. And I pray that, Father, the love that you have for us will be the same love that we have for you. This morning, we are driven to our knees in worship because of all the awesome things that we've experienced, the things that you have done in our lives. Lord, as I think about my salvation, as I think about all of the things that you have done for me, I can get lost in worship this morning. Meet us where we are in this life. Meet us where we are right now. Come and move among us as your people. Send the Holy Spirit to move among the pews and the chairs and to speak to hearts and lives right now. Draw us closer to you as we worship the true and living God. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
May be seated.
There's only one thing that continues, and that is the blood of Jesus Christ. So let's continue singing, "Nothing But the Blood."
Speaks a better word.
with Brother Calvin.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. How's everybody doing? Great. Brother Todd's got us at great. Well, I didn't really have time to prepare a message today, so I thought I would just read a little bit out of this book here. It's called The Prince of Egypt. Have y'all ever read that book before? No, James?
Solomon.
You saw the movie? Well, the book is so much better.
That's what they always
I figured I'd just read a little bit out of this. Would that be okay with y'all?
Be great.
All right, good deal. Okay, here we go. Long ago, a mighty Pharaoh ruled the land of Egypt. He was a man of power and dreams, a man who saw himself through history's eyes. Let me see here. A Hebrew mother was brave enough to hide her infant boy for 3 months.
You know, I'm off duty, Brother Calvin.
Huh?
It's not my teaching day.
Ramsey started to answer. I tell you what, this part just don't make sense. Let's just take this. I tell you what, this piece here doesn't even, Brother Calvin. Not any good.
Brother Calvin, what are you doing with that book?
Well, I'm taking out the pieces I don't like, okay? They just don't fit. Let's start again. Let's see, let me go to this part. Why did the gods torment me with such reckless, destructive, blasphemous sons? Said I was furious. Ramesses started to answer. This just isn't making any sense at all.
If you keep ripping out pages, you're not going to have any book left.
Well, hey, can I do this? Well, let's just start over. That's the best thing I think we should do. Long ago, a mighty Pharaoh ruled the land of Egypt. And the end. How about that? I mean, does that work for y'all? You know, this wasn't much of a story, was it? When you tear most of it out, like Miss Tina said. But you know, that's what we do a lot of times with God's Word, the Bible. We tear up and pull out the pieces we don't want, okay? That just doesn't make sense to us, does it, James? All those begattens and all of this begats, I mean, who can keep up with all of that, right? But it was the reason that it was in there, okay? And, you know, sometimes we have to read everything to learn what the Bible, what God is trying to say to us, okay? And if we tear out the pieces that we just like, it's really not going to make a whole lot of sense to us. You know, we can't skip over the parts we don't like and ignore the parts. You know, we have to read it. You know, but let me read you what Paul says about this in 2 Timothy 3:16. He says, all scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, training in righteousness. So we can't pick out and choose what parts of the Bible we want to obey and what parts we don't want to obey at all. That can be very difficult, but God gives us His Holy Spirit to help us. And you know, it is difficult, but we have to ask God to help us obey all of the Bible and all of the parts, and not just the parts that we feel like obeying. Okay? Alright? Well, I'm going to let y'all get back to singing, and I'll try to be better prepared next week to sing.
Alright.
Thank you.
You know, as we're talking about, you know, redemption. You know, I don't know what I would do without, you know, having Jesus Christ in my life and, you know, having somebody I can go to. I've got a kind of heavy heart this morning. I you know, saw right before I went to bed, you know, that we had a 1-year-old and a 3-year-old that died in a car, probably about half a mile from my house on Rental Cemetery Road. And they got in the car and basically suffocated because they couldn't get out. They didn't know how to get out. And they're connected with one of my boys that I'm very close to. They're cousins with them, and I got in touch with them this morning and talked to them. And I'd spent all yesterday with my Salvadorian sons at a birthday party, so they, you know, I was surrounded by little kids, you know, all day gibbering in Spanish and everything, and loving every minute of it. And you know, I think this morning about that family, you know, what they're going through. I know that they are believers and all, but that's the only thing that can get them. They could get them through. But just for our everyday lives, gosh, what would we do without Jesus Christ there? Knowing that we have him to go to pray, to you know, ask him for things, to thank him for things, and just be gracious for everything that he's given us. And it all started with the cross. So let's stand as we sing Hallelujah for the Cross.
Thank you.
teaches us. And so I want to tell you up front, this is going to be one of those sermons that some of you are going to say, man, you know what, I absolutely love it. And some of you are going to say, I absolutely hate this sermon. For some of you, the truth's going to set you free. You're going to be liberated. You're going to say, hey, this is something that I believe, I understand it, now I know why I believe it. Just remember that Jesus said the truth will set you free. It also will make you mad. So some of you may get mad. I just want to tell you up front, it's okay. You can get mad at me. You can do whatever you like. Send emails, text messages, however you like to do them. I read some of them for the most part. I just ignore them because I'm teaching the truth what the Scripture says, okay? And so this morning, it's going to be one of those sermons to where we're going to deal with the truth of the Scripture. We're going to talk about issues that the Bible does not directly address, and how you and I as believers ought to deal with those issues, okay? Believe it or not, there are some issues that the Bible does not directly address. I believe this. I believe the Bible in some shape, form, or fashion addresses every issue. But I'm talking about directly addressing specific things that we could go through. So here it is, right here, black and white, no question of that. There are some things that we have to deal with that we can't do that. So how do we deal with it? Well, Paul teaches us in the 14th chapter, starting in verse number 1, here's what he says. Him that is weak in the faith, receive ye, but not to doubt disputations. For one believeth that he may eat all things, another who is weak eateth herbs. Let not him that eateth despise him that eateth not, and let not him which eateth not judge him that eateth, for God hath received him. Who art thou that judgest another man's servant? To his own master he standeth to fall. Yea, he shall be held up, for God is able to make him stand. One man esteemeth one day above another, another esteemeth every day alike. Let every man be fully persuaded in his own mind. He that regardeth the day, regardeth it unto the Lord, and he that regardeth not the day, to the Lord he doth not regard it. He that eateth, eateth to the Lord, for he giveth God thanks, and he that eateth not to the Lord, he eateth not and giveth God thanks. For none of us liveth to him, and no man died to him. For whether we live in the Lord, and whether we die in the Lord. Whether we live, therefore, or die, we are the Lord's. For this end, Christ both died, and rose, and revived, that he might be Lord both of the dead and the living. But why dost thou judge thy brother? Or why dost thou set at naught thy brother? For we shall not all stand. For we shall not all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. For it is written, as I live, saith the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, every tongue shall confess to God. So then, every one of us shall give an account of himself to God. Let us not therefore judge one another any more, but judge this rather, that no man put a stumbling block or occasion to fall in his brother's way. I know. And I am persuaded by the Lord Jesus that there is nothing unclean of itself, but to him that esteemeth all things to be unclean, to him it is unclean. Let us pray. Over these next few moments, as we spend time looking at the passage of Scripture that sometimes, like Brother Calvin, people want to take and tear out. I want to deal with this. Sometimes it says what I wanted to say. Sometimes rather not say. Sometimes it fits in the way that I live my life. Sometimes it doesn't. I must admit that sometimes we would rather not deal with certain going to say, I've never heard that before, that's great. And some of you are going to say, preacher, I don't know about that. I'm going to have to do some more studying on it. I don't know. So I want to let you know, whatever category you fit in, whatever class you fit in, it's going to be okay. It's all right with me, all right? Whichever way did you find yourself, whatever category you find yourself in, it's going to be okay. So here, let's go through the scripture this morning. Real quick, there's a couple of things I want to address that Paul addresses here. I want to point out to you. And then there's some things that we're going to take up next week because it's 14 verses of scripture, right? 14 verses. First thing I want you to notice is this. It points out to us that there's three types of conduct. Some have said three types of behavior or three classifications, right? Three types of conduct, three types of behavior, three types of classification. So here's what he points out to us. There's something that is right. There's something that is wrong. Now, I want you to know this, that there are some things that are right and wrong. Don't miss what the Bible is saying here, that there are some moral absolutes. For those of you who do not believe that there are some moral absolutes, I want you to know this. According to the Bible, there are some things that are right, and there are some things that are wrong according to the Bible, right? This might be that real quick. Going in and out, so maybe the battery's this morning. There are some things that are right, and there are some things that are absolutely wrong. There are some people that will say, you can't know right from wrong. Everything's in this kind of gray area. Well, I want you to know this. There are some things that are right, and there are some things that are wrong according to the Bible. Okay, remember we talked about last week. Paul said this. Paul said, wake up, put on the armor of light. There's some behavior that you are not involved yourself in, orgies and drunkenness and selfishness and dissension and sexual immorality. Talk about those things, right? Those things, he said, for certain, are wrong, right? Bible points it out to us. There's no gray area whatsoever. Those things are wrong. There's some things in the Bible that are directed to us that we all know there's no debate about. The Bible says it's always wrong to tell a lie. There's no situation in which we can justify to say, I had to lie, right? To tell a lie is wrong, period. The Bible's plain and clear about that. The Bible's plain and clear about it's always wrong for a person to commit adultery. There's no situation, there's no way to justify it. The Bible's point blank clear. No situation, adultery is wrong. The Bible's point blank clear about sexual homosexual activity or homosexual behavior. It's always wrong, I know some people don't agree with this, to engage in homosexual activity. It's not a debate, it's not a gray area. The Bible points out it's absolutely wrong. The Bible also talks about murder, okay? There's no justification for murder at all. Murder is the taking of an innocent person's life. The Bible talks about murder. Murder is always wrong in the Bible. Murder is you taking an innocent person's life or another person taking a life of an innocent person. Murder is not when somebody goes to war and we're engaging in combat and soldiers have to take other soldiers' life. That's not murder, okay? It's not murder if you are defending yourself and you're put in a situation to where you have to protect your family and you have to end up taking the life of a person, okay? That's not murder. That is killing a person. That's not murder, okay? The Bible's talking about murder here. When you take it upon yourself for no reason, to take the life of another person, it's murder. The Bible says it's wrong. Some of you probably don't like this, but I believe this. When you choose to have an abortion, it's murder. Taking the life of an innocent baby, regardless of what you want to call it. raised right. And so from the get-go, know this, according to the Bible, there are absolutely things that are right and absolutely things that are wrong. There's some things that we face in life that don't fall neatly into those two categories. There's some things that we face, some areas of conduct that the Bible really does not address, right? Now, I know some of you are going, I think the Bible addresses every single area. I do too in broad terms, but when it comes to specific things like thou shalt not kill, murder, that they, it's not spelled out that easy in the scripture for us, right? And so there's a third type of behavior that I think Paul talks about, is the a matter of personal conviction, okay? Right things, wrong things, and a matter of personal conviction. There are some Christians who will say this morning that as a Christian, it is wrong, you can't do certain things. Let me give you an example. There may be some Christians in here that say, I have no problem with men wearing earrings. Okay? All right? Maybe some people would say that. As a Christian, I don't have a problem with men wearing earrings. There will be some people in here that will say this. As a Christian, I think it's absolutely wrong for men to wear earrings. Right? But when it comes to the Bible, that's one of those matters that's a personal conviction. Okay? Because it doesn't address it directly. Right? And I'm not saying that I'm for or against that. I'm just trying to give you an example. So Christians who say, I'm a Christian, I'm a guy, I wear earrings, nothing wrong with it. And there are guys who are Christians who say, that should never happen. Right? Paul also gives us a couple of examples in this particular passage of Scripture to help us understand. Here's one example that he gives to us when he talks about diet and things that we should drink. It comes to diet and drink, right? Now let me give you a little background. In the Roman church, there were some people who came out of idol worship, that's paganism, and they would take the finest cattle, and they would sacrifice the finest cattle, and they would sacrifice it to one of the pagan gods, false idols. And they would only take a little bit of the meat, and they would put it on the altar, and they would burn that meat. They would take the rest of the meat, and here's what they'd do. They'd sell the good meat to the public, and the people in the public would buy it. So people bought this meat, and they ate it up, right? Well, there were some Christians that said, well, hold on a second. As a Christian, you can't eat that meat because it was sacrificed to an idol. There were some Jewish Christians that said, hold on a second. We're going to get believers now. We're no longer part of Judaism, but we know for a fact that you shouldn't eat that meat because you don't know the way that that meat was killed, so you don't know if it's kosher meat or not, so you shouldn't eat the meat anyway. So the best thing to do in their eyes was you just don't eat any meat. There were some other Christians who were in the church that said, you know what? No big deal to me. I could care less if they sacrificed the cow to a false idol because it's a false idol. It has no power. It has no authority whatsoever. The meat's cheap, the meat's good, and I'm going to eat it. So what's the big deal? And there they had a disagreement. They disagreed over it. Now I want you to know this. I like things in this neat, well-defined little box where I can go and point to it and say, here's how it is. Look, right here it is. Okay? And I would prefer that if I had a chance to talk to the Apostle Paul, I'd give him a little advice. I prefer you to put down here, address the issue and say, just don't eat meat, period, and settle the issue. That's not what he did. Here's what he said. There are some Christians that will, and there are some Christians that won't eat the meat because it's a matter of personal conviction. That's how he addressed it. For those who believe they shouldn't eat the meat, don't eat it. Those of you who believe it's okay to eat it, eat it. Matter of personal conviction. If it's not, he will say, hey, we'll settle the issue. Don't eat the meat sacrificed to that idol. That's what he was saying. Not only was there that issue, but there was the issue to be addressed in this passage of Scripture about the issue of day. Verse number 5. One man considered one day more sacred than the other. That was in Paul's day. And there's this deal here. There were some Christians that came out of Judaism that were still keeping Saturday, observing the Sabbath. They were also going and worshiping on Sunday. There was this other group of new Gentile Christians that came into the church, and they said, hey, you guys, if you want to be a Christian, then you have to observe all the Sabbath and all the regulations. You can't walk more than half a mile. You can't work. You can't cook. You can't do all these things on Sunday. So some of the Christians were coming and saying, no. There's no day that's any more important than any other day. Now, those are some of the issues in the Bible. They didn't get addressed directly. Paul said this. It's a matter of personal conviction. It's a matter of personal conviction. That's what he said. That leads to the third thing, don't you, to see here. It kind of brings us more up to date. Not dealing with the issues that Paul was dealing with in his day, but some of the modern issues that we deal with today, right? You might want to call them the taboos of today. And so when we talk about some of the issues today involving Christians in the church, we'll put them in this category. Taboos or not? That'd be the question. The question would be more direct like this. Preacher, you tell me, is this right or is this wrong for Christians to do? Some Christians say they're right. Some Christians say they're wrong. Some Christians can't even agree to disagree. Some lovingly disagree. It's okay, right? So let's give some of the things that I've heard over the years that I've been in ministry that people want to address. Can Christians do this or not? I believe this is a sin. I don't think it's a sin at all. I think Christians should do this, or I think Christians shouldn't do this. So let's go through some of the modern taboos. You decide, taboo or not. Today, people say, if you're a Christian, you should not smoke tobacco. If you smoke tobacco, then it's a sin. It's one of those taboos, right? Taboo or not? Well, somebody ask you a question. Can a Christian smoke tobacco? Some of you are sitting here going, no. Some of you are sitting here going, yes. What's the answer? I can light up a cigarette and smoke it right now. Who's going to stop me from doing that? So you mean to tell me that if I'm a Christian now, if I lit a cigarette up and smoked it, that I'd no longer be a Christian? So can a Christian smoke tobacco? Some say yes, some say no. When it comes to dancing, they'll say, hey, Christians shouldn't participate in things like that. They shouldn't dance. The question I get, preacher, do Baptists dance or not? I can answer that. Honestly, yeah, some do, some don't. Some can dance, some can't dance. Some should, some shouldn't. I don't know. Playing cards, taboo or not? Christians shouldn't play cards. Boy, if you play cards, then it's a sin. You've been disappointed in our first church, because I love to play rook. We had fellowship every last Sunday night celebrating birthdays, and after we got through it, me and the deacons went into one of the classrooms, and we played rook. One lady in our church came in, and we all thought, oh, man, this happens. This is over. Came in and opened up all the doors we're in, and there we are, me with all the deacons playing rook, building the card, and she walked in, and so, I'm about to tell y'all, we quit playing rook, but we didn't. So, she thought playing cards, oh, you don't play cards in the church, you don't play cards, you just don't play cards, it's a sin, it's a Christian. Now, ask her about dominoes, it's okay. You know why? Because she played dominoes. It's all right. How about chewing tobacco? Taboo or not? A Christian shouldn't chew tobacco. A Christian shouldn't dip. How about drinking wine? A Christian should have a glass of wine. A Christian shouldn't have a glass of wine. Taboo or not? How about when people say, preacher, what do you think about males and females swimming together? And they're not married. Taboo or not? Should males and females go to the same swimming pool together? had people tell me,
preacher, I'll tell you something. If you read out of any other translation, the King James, you're wrong. It's a sin against God.
Really?
I'm sure that's black and white, isn't it?
And people say shopping on Sunday is a sin. Taboo or not? Is it a sin? I've had people tell me, if you watch or participate in sports on Sunday, it's a sin. If you work on Sunday, guess what? It's a sin. If you listen to secular music, it's a sin. If you read secular magazines, it's a sin. For a woman to wear makeup, it's a sin. All you ladies that wear makeup, answer the question. It's what some people say, right? Others say it's a sin for some not to wear makeup. That's another debate we will have at some point in time. Some people say that women shouldn't cut their hair. Some people say that a woman should never wear pants. Never wear pants to church, and never wear pants outside the church. So some people say it's a sin if you do that. So you see the list of things that, just some of the things that I've heard through the years, are they taboo? Are these things that are wrong for people to do? You probably got your own list. You probably add stuff to the list that I had just read to you that I've heard. You've probably heard that Christians shouldn't smoke. If you're a Christian, there's no way you would want to smoke. It's a sin. Let me just give you an example real quick. The Amish people, if you study the Amish people, okay, very religious, devout people, right? They don't use automobiles because they believe it's a sin. They don't use electricity, and there's a lot of other things that they don't use. But it probably interests you enough this. They grow tobacco and sell tobacco, and most of them smoke. They claim to be Christians. There are more Baptists, especially in Alabama, kind of teeter-totter back and forth. Can Christians drink? Can Christians not drink? If you go over to Germany, you'll be surprised. German Baptists drink beer. You're going to be really shocked. German Baptists serve beer at the church supper when they have fellowship. They claim to be Christians. I heard a preacher one time preach a sermon on smoking cigarettes. And he told the story. He said, I was up preaching this sermon, and he said, every time I would talk about it's a sin to smoke and Christians shouldn't smoke, he said, this lady would, amen, that's right, preacher, amen, preach it, it's a sin. He was excited about that. He said, at the end of the sermon, he got through preaching, and they were getting ready to dismiss, and she stood up when she got ready to go, and she pulled her can of smokeless tobacco out and put it in her cheek right there in the church. Walked to the back of the church and said to the preacher, best sermon I've ever heard, and I agree with every word of it. Smoking is a sin. And it just infuriated him. I mean, it set him on fire. He couldn't contain himself, he said, madam, you have the audacity to stand here and tell me smoking is a sin when I watched you put that dip in your mouth right after I got through preaching. How dare you say that? You did that, right? She said, I absolutely did, preacher, and I still agree. This stuff's too good to burn and waste. Put it in your mouth and chew it. So most of you are probably saying now, so preacher, are you trying to tell us that smoking and dipping is okay? No, that's not what I'm saying. Now, I'm not saying that all those other things that I said is okay. What I'm trying to say is there's some things that are not directly addressed in the Bible. Okay? If you have found in the Bible where it says, thou shalt not smoke cigarettes, then show it to me because I haven't found it. It's not that plain and clear directly. Okay? It's not. And it's definitely not in there, thou shalt not chew tobacco. Okay? Baptist preachers of all time, Charles Haddon Spurgeon, may shock some of you, smoked cigars. And his whole congregation knew that he smoked cigars. One of the greatest preachers of all time. So with all these things that are kind of taboos, you might say, how in the world are we to gauge what we're to do and what we're not to do? Are there some guidelines? Yes, there are some guidelines. I want you to jot them down. The guidelines on how we ought to judge or conduct ourselves as believers. First is this. Ask yourself, is this prohibited in the Bible? What I'm doing, whatever it is it prohibited in the Bible? We'll talk about some of those things. If it's adultery, you don't even have to think about it. If it's in the Bible, it is wrong. You shouldn't do it. Okay? It's over with. It's settled. It's in the Bible. Second thing is this. Ask yourself, this that I'm doing, can God bless it? Can God take this behavior and receive honor and glory from it? Can he bless this activity, this behavior that I'm doing? Look down at verse number 6. It says, even the one who eats meat can say, thank you, Lord, that I don't eat meat. But the one who does eat meat can say, thank you, Lord, that I do eat the meat. Thank you. Both ways. See? Third question that you can ask yourself is this. What I'm doing, Christ came back right now. But I want him to find me engaged in that activity. Would I be willing for him to confront me face to face with the activity that I'm doing? And those are the guidelines that I kind of use in my life. And applying those guidelines, most of those things that we talked about that are taboos, you can ask the ones that are closest to me, I don't do, and we don't do. Not because we're better than anybody else. Not because we're preacher's family. But we don't do some of those things that everybody else does because I don't see how in the world God can bless some of those things. And if God can't bless it, shouldn't be doing it, right? I mean, if I would be embarrassed for God to see me if Jesus came back face to face, I don't want anything to do with it. That's not the basis that we use. We taught our children the same thing. There's some things that are absolutely right. You can do them. There's some things, no, you shouldn't do them. There's some things that are a matter of personal conviction. Now, that being said, the second thing that Paul talks about here, he talks about two kinds of believers. Two kinds of believers, not two kinds of believers. He talks about a weak Christian. What is a weak Christian? Notice two times there, verse number one, verse number two, except those or him whose faith is weak, and then in verse two, another man whose faith is weak eats only vegetables. Weak Christians, sometimes live under what I would call legalism, okay? Let me give you a couple of characteristics of a weak Christian who is a legalistic type person. You can tell a Christian who is legalistic because their list of things that they can do and can't do, things that they should do and shouldn't do, is a lot longer than the list that God has, okay? Now, you find somebody who has a list that's a lot longer than the things that God has, of things that they can't do, and things that everybody else can do, and things that everybody shouldn't do. And I'm telling you, you're fighting a person who is weak in their faith, and they fall in the category of legalism, okay? So you got to ask yourself, do I believe what I believe because of tradition, because something somebody's told me? Or do I believe what I believe because it says it here in the Word of God and I can point to it? That's what you have to decide, all right? The second characteristic of the weak Christian is they often condemn those who don't follow their leads, right? They got their own set of rules, rights and wrongs, and if you don't follow their list, then you're wrong.
like, you know, if you're not really miserable, then you're not really being a good Christian. I want you to know this. I have a wonderful time being a born-again believer. And if you think that you have to be miserable being a Christian, then you miss the boat. Life's fun. God wants us to have fun. God wants us to enjoy life. But we can do it doing those things that glorify Him and bring honor to Him and stay away from those things that don't. It's just that simple. We just choose not to. The person who's legal, listen, you've got to follow my list or you're wrong. Even when it comes to certain days of the week. There's some people in this room right now who believe that you can't do anything on Sunday. You can't read the paper. You can't have recreation. You can't do anything. It's a day of rest, and that's all you do. You go to worship. You go home and rest, and that's it. And I want to say up front, for those who believe that, God bless you. I'm not going to argue against that. It is the Lord's Day, and it is a day of rest. And by the way, I want to tell you this. We have cheapened the Lord's Day to the point that I'm afraid if we don't stop doing some of the things that we're doing as adults and as Christians, then we're going to raise kids who see no need for the Lord's Day at all. Okay? But to have the mindset that you can't do anything on Sunday at all except worship for rest, or it's a sin, I don't know about that. So let me ask you this. What about those Christians who believe they come and worship on Sunday? They can serve the Lord on Sunday. They do all the things that we have offered, and they can still go and do some of the things that they enjoy doing. They can still go participate in a recreational activity. They can still go have fun. They can still go visit, shop, or whatever else. And they can do it with a clear conscience. Are they wrong? Have they missed the boat? Have they? I'm going to give you a word of caution when it comes to the Lord's Day, all right? I joked yesterday about cutting grass today. And my daughter's like, no, you're not. And she knew right off the bat, my grass needs to be cut. I didn't cut it yesterday. I didn't cut any this week. When I had a church tonight, right, I'm going to cut the grass. No, I'm not. Can I do it? Absolutely. Think God's going to come and stop me from cutting the grass today, or going to strike me dead, or going to condemn me to hell, take my salvation away because I go home and cut the grass? Not going to happen. Okay? But you know why I won't go and cut my grass today? Because I'm afraid somebody may see that's not a believer and think that I'm cheapening the Lord's Day. That's why I won't do it. I don't care how high it gets, I'm not going to cut it on Sunday. If you go home and cut your grass on Sunday, I'll never say a word to you. If you stay home from church, cut your grass, and I come to church, different story. Okay? You got to understand, is it a matter of tradition, or is it what the Bible teaches us? And there's some Christians who say, when it comes to Halloween, we're Christians, and let me tell you what, we should never participate in that holiday. For those who believe you shouldn't do anything on Sunday, I applaud you. Those of you who think you should come to church and worship and still do things on Sunday, I applaud you. It's a matter of personal conviction. Again, don't cheapen the Lord's Day. Be careful that you're not raising your family in such a way that when your children become adults, that they see no need for even going to church because you just cheapen it to the point where we go through the motions and then do whatever else we want to do. Be careful of that. Because it's happening today, right? But when it comes to Halloween, what do you do when Christians say that's something we should participate in? I had a lady one time, right after, it's probably 2 or 3 years after we came here, and we had a fall festival, we moved it outside, and then it was probably about the first big fall festival that we had, we kind of pushed in the community, and we had a really good turnout, and we did some things, I was really pleased with it, and after that, I ran into this lady, and she lit me up. Don't you know Christians shouldn't participate in Halloween? Don't you know that that's
that's a holiday that celebrates the devil, it's of the devil, and don't you know that it's wrong for you as a pastor to even have your church be involved in something like Halloween? I'll tell you, she lit me up pretty good. Now, for those of you who know me, if you're a female and you want to light me up, I'm going to let you light me up, all right? I'm not going to be disrespectful to you. I'm not going to tell you what I think or anything else, because I think that's wrong for a man to do to a female, okay? So if you want to light me up, light me up. If you're a guy and you light me up like that, I'm probably going to walk away from you and say, hey, see, you're entitled to your own opinion and move on. It's not worth the conversation, right? And then, believe it or not, I'm always in those situations where somebody really lights you up. I always want to try to come out with something positive that's being spewed as negative. And in this particular day, I was struggling. Boy, she was giving it to me, and I thought, these people are listening to this and stuff, and she's doing it right here in public. What in the world can I do that's positive? The Lord said, just keep your mouth shut. Kept my mouth shut. And he gave to me something that was positive. Here's what I'm going to share with you. He said, son, be thankful that you're not married to that woman. Be thankful you don't have to go home and live with her. You just get them a little bit. Can you imagine what her husband's getting? I'm pretty happy with that. And I came real close to saying, I take it we don't need to put a flyer on your door next year when we do the fall festival, because we still want to do it. It's going to be about to be a parking lot. Right? But I respected what she was saying and agreed with it. Right? But I understood she's a weak Christian, because her list of things, if I follow them, I'm going to be okay. But if I don't, mark me off the list. But he talks about Christians who are strong Christians. Christians who believe what the Bible says. And some of you have a question. Do you think Paul is a weak Christian or a strong Christian? Go to chapter 15, verse number 1. Here's what it says. He who are strong bear with the weak. Paul's in the strong camp. Paul would have been one of those who said, it's okay to eat the meat. Paul would have been one of those who said, there's no other day that's any more sacred than any other. By the way, I think that every single day when we're born again believers, we are treated as if it's the Lord's day and worship Him and demonstrate who we are as God's people. Period. Okay? No matter where we're at, no matter what we're doing, we are God's people, and it doesn't change. Paul would be in that category. There are seven things that on people's list that will set them free and say, you know what? There's certain things that I'm a strong Christian, I believe shouldn't happen. I've had people tell me when we put the drums up, you know, I don't know if we should have drums in the church or not. Why is that? Because I don't think the Bible, you know, makes room for that. Okay? You know, well, let me just read it to you. Psalm 150. Praise the Lord with clashing cymbals and sound of drums. What are we going to do? Brother Calvin, tear that part out? You can, and it'll fit your narrative. Shouldn't happen in the church. Guess what? It's okay to have drums in church. It's okay to have a guitar in church. It's okay to have a piano, an organ, whatever else that we want to add. As long as it's enhancing our worship to the one true and living God, and not because of tradition we think that it should be done or shouldn't be done because that's what we believe. See, I told you some of you are going to get mad about it, right? Some of you probably get mad right now and say, no, I don't. So I really don't see a problem. This is me. This is me who got through it. I don't see a problem with a man walking into the sanctuary and wearing a hat. I don't. Okay? I don't. Some of you would fall out if I walked in here with a hat on and started preaching this morning. You'd probably get up to leave. Because you believe there's no way a person wears a hat in the sanctuary because it's disrespectful, right? The only problem is it doesn't teach us that in God's Word. But you know why I choose not to wear the hat? It's because there's some people that really believe that it's offensive. And if it's offensive to you, why would I do that? I would never put an earring in my ear as a male. I didn't allow my son to do that. But biblically speaking, there's really nothing wrong with a man who sticks an earring in his ear. You think it's going to send him to hell, or is that me with sin? You know why I wouldn't let my son do it, or why I wouldn't do it? It's because some people believe that it shouldn't be done by males and Christians. You know why I no longer smoke tobacco or chew tobacco or drink alcoholic beverages? Not because I'm better than anybody else, but because there are Christians who believe that you shouldn't, as a believer, do that. You may be sitting here saying, so preacher, you're going to just adapt your whole life to what other people think? But I'm going to live out what the Scripture teaches me. And if I know that it causes you to stumble, I shouldn't do it. Pretty plain and clear, isn't it? That's where we get back to the respect that we have for each individual. Their homes, their families, to respect them. That's what it's about. I'm going to tell you this. For those who engage in some of those activities, nobody has to tell you you shouldn't do it, because if you're a born-again believer, the Holy Spirit of God has already spoken to your heart. He's already convicted you of it. Nobody has to tell you. I'm not going to point it out to you. I don't have to. If you're a believer, I don't have to do that. And if you bought into the fact that you can still do those things, and you can still be effective for the Lord, I'm going to tell you this, then you're wrong. Because I witness to people on a daily basis who tell me, listen to me, tell me, I don't want to go to church, and I don't want to be a Christian, because I see too many people walk in the doors of the church who claim to be Christians, who smoke, who curse, who drink, who commit adultery, who do all those things that we can't think that are taboos. And I'm going to tell you this, it has to stop if we want to have an impact on our society. Now you know why I choose not to participate in those things. It might not. I can tell you for a fact, it won't send me to hell if I participate in those. And it might be sending other people to hell who will never commit their life to Christ because they don't want to be like you and like me. And I want to tell you that. That is heart-wrenching. So I want to challenge you. There's some things that you know you should do because the Bible says don't do. There's some things that you can do because the Bible says do. There's some things that are of a personal matter. You get to choose a preference, whatever it is that's in there. You have to decide. But when you decide, keep this in mind. Does it bring honor and glory to the Father? Would I be willing to stand before the Father and He'll return right now and be participating? If not, listen to me. Quit. Don't participate. It's not worth it. There's no benefit to it. And until we get back to living our lives like that, we can't experience the joy of our salvation and all that God has to offer for us. I just want to challenge you right now. Whatever it is, there's some things that I have to give. for 1 week. At the end of that 1 week, after you prayed every day, you abstained from it every day, God didn't do a work in your life, and just go back to doing it. If you don't see any benefit whatsoever, just go back to doing it. Okay? But be open and honest until what God will do a work in your life. God will show you when you don't need that and how it can benefit somebody else. Don't be selfish in it. How it can benefit somebody else. Just maybe the person that's never invited Jesus in their heart and life. Just try it. Been there, done it. Just try it. God will set you free. Would you stand with me this morning with your head bowed and your eyes closed? Bashful, don't be ashamed. Run to the Father. hospital and the doctors would have all figured it out. No, I thank you for